Dear Valve. That's right, you heard me. Valve, purveyors of every game on the planet that isn't gobbled up by EA and Ubisoft's shitty front ends. You know what I'm writing to you about today. You've probably been wincing for months, expecting my content-hungry YouTuber gaze to fall upon you, or you've been too busy hiding from your problems behind a giant stack of money you've accrued from your invention of Steam. In either case, I'm writing to you today about Half-Life. Not, of course, to pester you about Half-Life 3. I'm reasonably certain that's never gonna happen. I mean, by now, our expectations would be absurdly huge. There's no possible way you could conclude the series without disappointing an assload of people, which is why you shouldn't have waited so long in the first place. I mean, who the fuck does that? Jesus fucking Christ! Anyway, I'm not here for that, even though I'm pretty sure Half-Life 3 would make some fucking brilliant clickbait in the thumbnail. Will I find a way to put it in there? Who knows? That's a job for future Austin to worry about. I'm here to tackle the big one, the topic that's come up in the comments of almost every video I've done. People want, nay, people need to know about one thing: the gravity gun. And you know what? I'm fucking ready. Does your gravity gun hold up to scientific rigor? Let's find out! Now, I have to say that I dug deep into gravity while researching this topic, and in order to move forward, we have to talk about a few things. There are a few core ideas that we have to understand in order to move forward and talk about how one could possibly utilize gravity as a force, well, sort of a force, more on that in a bit, to move something else. Gravity is kind of a big deal in our everyday lives. Newton's first law of motion asserts that an object in motion stays in motion unless acted upon by an outside or net force. Gravity, therefore, is the outside force that keeps us from zipping off into the abyss of outer space whenever we jump. It's also what keeps our atmosphere from floating away and ultimately holds our planet together. Speaking of Newton, Isaac Newton is credited for developing our very first fundamental conceptions of gravity with the development of the universal law of gravitation, F equals m1 times m2 divided by r squared times g, where F is the force of gravitation, G is the gravitational constant, M1 and 2 are the masses of the two objects you're measuring, and R is their distance apart from one another. This law, this rule that Isaac Newton established over 300 fucking years ago before spaceships or penicillin or computers existed, has withstood the test of time and has been used to accurately predict the model of gravity of every planet in our solar system. Isaac Newton was a motherfucking badass. Of course, well, it's not perfect. Don't get me wrong, Newton is incredible, and Newtonian concepts are perfect under most normal gravitational circumstances and conditions. Sometimes, though, well, sometimes the universe is fucking weird. For instance, there's Mercury. F equals m1 times m2 divided by r squared times g works perfectly when it comes to measuring every single planet in our solar system. In fact, it was used to predict the existence and location of Neptune before it was actually discovered in 1846. That is, all planets except for Mercury. You see, every single planet is predictably modeled within, like, inches using Newton. Considering we don't know the exact universal distribution of mass, this is pretty damn impressive. Mercury, though, well, things were off. Off for reasons we didn't quite understand. And then there's light. Oh, light, you tricksy minx. Nothing makes folk madder on this channel than when I talk about light, but today we're gonna do it. We must bring that formula up again. All right. So, look at this. According to this, everything in the universe has gravity, which is true. Let's take me for an example. I weigh approximately 61 kilograms, and the Earth weighs a buttload of kilograms, 5.972 yottograms to be precise. My center of gravity is 637,100 meters from the center of the Earth. Taking this and plugging in the gravitational constant, we get a gravitational force of 601 newtons, which, if we did our math correctly, should equal the same amount of force as me accelerating at 1g, or 9.8 meters per second squared. And it is! So, this makes sense. Just standing on the ground, I exert 601 newtons on the ground. Pretty cool, huh? You can do this math too using your own body. So what about light? Well, photons have no mass. Shut up, no they don't. So they shouldn't be affected by gravity, right? Well, that's the theory. But unfortunately, this is not the case. Light is totally affected by gravity. This was first noticed by scientists during a solar eclipse when the light of the sun was blotted out. Folk noticed that they could actually see a star that should have been behind the sun, but instead looked like it was slightly to the left. What was happening was that the light was shining and was actually bending around the sun due to gravity and looping back to us. And according to Isaac Newton, this should not be possible. If you pop a zero in for your mass two, it doesn't matter how massive your mass one is, the measure of gravitational force will always, always be zero. Light has perpetually been a tricky conundrum to physics, a stick in the mud, if you will, going all the way back to the very first theory of relativity, Galilean relativity, which is a bit complex but can be pretty easily summarized with the train analogy. So if you're standing on a train going a consistent 100 kilometers an hour and throw a hot dog down a hallway at 30 kilometers an hour, since you're not accelerating to your frame of reference, the hot dog will be traveling at only 30 kilometers an hour. However, if someone is standing outside of the train and they happen to look in the window just as you pass them, they'll measure the hot dog is traveling down the hallway at 130 kilometers an hour. And if someone were, I don't know, immortal and were standing on the surface of the sun and had the best eyesight ever and could see the hot dog from 100 million kilometers away, they'd perceive the hot dog as traveling between 109,470 and 109,730 kilometers an hour, depending upon which direction the train was traveling, taking into account the rotation of the Earth and the speed of its orbit around the sun. Photons, though, are tricky. If the people on the train were to do the same thing as they did with the hot dog, but used a flashlight instead, they'd measure the photons as traveling at 299,000 meters per second. The person standing outside, the same damn thing. No matter how you slice it, with velocity, acceleration, or gravity, light just wants to take a big old shit on classical physics. These problems literally broke the brains of physicists for fucking years until one man busted in like the goddamn Kool-Aid man and blew everyone's fucking minds. Albert Einstein. It's impossible to overstate Einstein's contribution to physics. Most great thinkers of the modern era are satisfied completely revolutionizing a field in one way. But Einstein redefined both physics and the entire universe as we think of it. My favorite thing about Einstein, if I can be real for a second, is his particular methodology for working through problems. Einstein more or less showed that anybody could be a genius if they'd only just adjust the way they approach problems. Before he ever proved anything using decades of difficult math, he first sat down and just thought about stuff, asking himself, what makes sense? So he said, if you were in a box with no windows, you wouldn't be able to tell the difference between being in outer space and accelerating at acceleration g, 9.8 meters per second squared, and sitting on the surface of the Earth, which pulls you down with a force of g. This is called the principle of equivalence. Furthermore, if you shine a light in box A, the one traveling through space, and were somehow able to measure its position as the light beam traveled, it would appear to bend as light travels in a straight line, but you are accelerating forward. So to that end, if you traveled forward, the light would be, relative to you, traveling downward and would appear to curve. And since both box A and box B are exactly the same would happen in box B under Earth's gravity. And guess what? It fucking does! After more or less working through this on a napkin, Einstein devoted his entire career into discovering why this is and developed two major groundbreaking theories, special relativity and general relativity. This is a bit of an oversimplification, but general relativity, which came later, tends to deal more with gravity in regards to space-time, and special relativity deals more with the behavior of light, but they're both consistent with one another. In his work, Einstein figured out that gravity actually isn't a force at all, like Newton thought it was. Instead, gravity is the distortion of space-time by energy. And energy is a very, very specific term and is incredibly important here because it's not just about mass. For the most part, mass and energy are interchangeable, according to Einstein, and a somewhat archaic and mostly unused term by modern physicists, but still correct, is relativistic mass. For example, in the case of me and the Earth, both my body body and the Earth have mass under the laws of Newton, and so we both attract to one another. Einstein says, no, that's not a force of attraction. Instead, what's happening is the energy of you, the you-ness, is actually bending space-time around your body. The Earth, being way more massive than you, is bending it a hell of a lot more. Being adjacent to one another, both me and the Earth kind of fall into each other's curved local space-times. Obviously, with the Earth having way more mass, and by extension, way more energy, I have pretty much negligible impact on its life. And this is why light bends in spite of having no mass, in the classical sense. As it travels in a straight line through space, it hits localized space-time ripples, and traveling in that straight direction follows the curves of space-time. It's due to this effect that we were off when it came to measuring Mercury's orbit. Since it's so close to the Sun, it's affected by the deeper space-time curvature. Interestingly enough, this actually means that light does have gravity since it has energy. It weighs 0 kilograms and moves fast as fuck, but it can distort space-time. And what's really fucking cool, though, is if you work your way through Einstein's incredibly complicated field equations, you actually find that under normal gravitational circumstances, they actually resemble Newton's very own laws of gravitation, albeit with way, way more moving parts. It's actually pretty incredible because this actually means that Einstein proved Newton right, as long as you're within the normal constraints of Newtonian physics. People often act like Einstein usurped Newton, but in reality, he just expanded upon his previous work and made it more broadly applicable. Isn't that fucking incredible? Which brings us, at last, back to the gravity gun. We more or less have everything we need to know in order to figure out how this fucking beast works. So, how does it? Well, using a complex method of measurement involving standardized legal-sized filing cabinets, wooden planks, and an antique 15-tube radiator that's 67 centimeters high, 82 centimeters wide, and 18 centimeters deep, comprised of 5% cast iron with a density of 6,800 kilograms per cubic meter for a total estimated mass of 340 kilograms, I was able to determine the gravitational space-time curve strength of the gravity gun with science! And the science is goddamned terrifying! The radiator accelerates at 91.36 meters per second squared over a distance of 2 meters in 0.15 seconds. Now, following normal gravitational rules as we know them, in order to pull these kinds of forces, which are more powerful than the Earth's gravity by a factor of 10, the gravity gun would have to be generating mass energy of 5 petagrams at 707 petagrams per cubic meter, 700,000 times the density of a fucking white dwarf star. But whatever. This is a world where fucking teleportation exists. I'm not gonna say this is impossible. Hell, Gordon Freeman was put into a super stasis for 20 years somehow. This thing is called a zero-point energy field manipulator, so it's possible it's pulling this kind of energy out of the currently unexplored quantum vacuum energies. Let's just presume the energy and mass requirements aren't bullshit. I'm just an asshole, not a monster. Of course, something of this mass would be pulling all things in around it. Walls, boxes, all in a perfect sphere. Everything would come collapsing inward. Anybody who's played Half-Life 2 will know this isn't how the gravity gun works. It pulls stuff from in front of it. I'll be honest, according to modern understandings of how space-time curvature works, this is fucking impossible. But whatever. Let's fucking try it. Who gives a shit? Let's pretend it's possible. Moving outward and moving in a cone in front of you, the effective gravity field actually takes up only 5% of the space it would if it were affected by a sphere around you, which means that our energy requirements drop an assload to, only 300 teragrams. And what's that in normal English? 3/4 of the total mass energy of the entire human population, all condensed into this tiny little fucking gun. Instead of being 700,000 times the density of a white dwarf, it's only 36,000 times its density. Yeehaw! But whatever, we found out how the gravity gun works. It simply has a huge fucking mass that weighs as much as nearly the entire human race, condensed until it is as tightly compact as a star is. No biggie. I hope that thing never fails in any way. It'd probably crack the Earth in half. And presuming it doesn't rip the entire city down along the path it's fired, along with pulling whatever bullshit nonsense you're using to chuck at literal monsters, and presuming it somehow manages to negate its massive, mass enough for you to actually carry it by creating a portal to a distant neutron star in space, it doesn't even fucking matter. Remember how I keep comparing it to white dwarf stars? That's because this thing is pulling incredible energy densities of space-time that are fucking terrifying. And at these densities, do you know what happens? Fucking nuclear fusion. Atoms are getting smashed together so tightly that they're crashing together to form brand new elements. This means that every time you fire this gravity gun, it's gonna be fusing atoms together as soon as the local space-time collapses as tight as a fucking star, sending gamma and other terrifying forms of radiation flying in all directions. Holy shit, that's why it's called Half-Life. Its implicit story is all about Gordon Freeman dying from acute radiation poisoning and never saving the world like he was supposed to. We're never gonna get a Half-Life 3 because Gordon Freeman is fucking dead from super cancer. I did it! I solved the riddle! So, now that we know how the gravity gun would work, a word of caution. Use the gravity gun sparingly. The damn things are dangerous. Really ask yourself, is getting bathed with lethal doses of stellar radiation really worth flinging an armoire at your enemies for the rebellion? Sincerely, Austin. P.S. Guess what, guys? We're moving! Well, I mean, not really. The show is to Wednesdays instead of Mondays. It's just gonna make some stuff easier for us, but otherwise, it's the same thing. Too many minutes of me making fanboys angry. So when next Monday rolls around and this ain't here, don't panic. It'll just be two more days. You can make it. Also, I'm gonna be streaming Half-Life 2 right now. Well, maybe right now. Starting at 10 a.m. Central Standard Time, head on over to twitch.tv/idcast and catch me starting a new playthrough on the hardest possible difficulty setting. I will die a lot and rage at the shitty, shitty old puzzles. Thank you everyone for watching my video on the gravity gun. This thing is absurd and stupid. It would never work. At least not reusing gravity at all. But you know, Portal exists in the same universe. I'm pretty sure aperture science is a thing. So, you know, they take space-time and Einstein and piss on them and bend them to their will. Yeah, so that's pretty cool. I might do Portal eventually, which would actually be way more complicated than the gravity gun. So that'll be fun. We could get around to that. I hope you liked it. If you liked it, please like it. And if you are new here, hey, subscribe to our channel. I do this stuff every freaking week, and it's a good time. I'd like to throw out a personal thank you to our Patreon supporters who make this show and every show that we do possible. You guys are the best. And hey, if you love this show and you want to see more episodes like it, you can head on over to our Patreon page yourself and contribute whatever you want. If you donate, if you contribute $3 a month, you actually get early access to videos like this one as soon as they're done. This one, for instance, is probably going to be available to people late on Saturday or early on Sunday, which is just a day, but you know, a day is a day is a day is a day. You get it even earlier and earlier and earlier and earlier. I'm gonna go now and actually make this thing happen. Because they don't just like, it doesn't just like form out of my being into completion. I have to record it and then I have to edit it and do all that stuff. Oh, look, and I think we should have our new annotations up today. The new style of YouTube annotations. If you have Adblock on, you can't see them. Ah, jerk. You're not a jerk. I love you. Mwah. Turn off Adblock.